Welcome to Solitary Nation. My name is Matt Duhamel, your host. This is a special video series for Gonzaga University for their International Conference on Hate Studies. My first guest is Dr. Roger Lancaster. He studied and was educated at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and the University of California, Berkeley, where he earned his PhD in cultural anthropology. I also want to mention this is brought to you by Women Against Registry. Welcome, Dr. Roger Lancaster, to the show. How are you today?
I'm great. Thank you. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you very much. Tell our viewers and listeners a little bit about yourself and how you got involved in studying the sex offender registry and those different areas that are all combined together, like hate and discrimination.
My motives for becoming involved in this were in some ways personal. I mean, I think often research is motivated by personal stuff. I accompanied a school teacher friend, a very close friend, through a series of legal hassles. Started with what I'm confident was a false accusation. It was an accusation that shifted, morphed, and changed over several different iterations. Hard to say exactly what the actual accusation was. In the legal sequence of these things, it's often quite murky. At the end of a trial process, he was convicted. I think everyone who's read the transcripts say that judge made a strange decision, because here you had an what looks like establishing more than reasonable doubt. But he was convicted, spent 90 days in jail. And came out of the process a registered sex offender, and his career was ruined. He'll never work again in his field of education. Because I accompanied him through every stage of this process, it was like I could see up close and personal how the system worked and how problematic and flawed the process could be. So I wrote about it in my 2011 book, Sex Panic in the Punitive State. Needless to say, I don't just write, you know, a journalistic or anecdotal account, right? I mean, there's an ethnographic chapter that walks readers through some of the sex offender laws that we have now, some of the procedures that we have now, the way the court process seems. You know, so I try to provide a history of that.
Some people watching this and listening may not know what they've probably heard the term registered sex offender, but what is a registered sex offender? I mean, is there a one answer for that?
It takes in a very wide range of offenses, some of which are violent and degrading and obviously cause for extreme alarm, and some of which if you take it down to some of the more mundane levels, two teenagers making out, at least one of them could come out of the process a registered sex offender in some states under some legal categories. Age of consent laws are an important part of it.
A lot of people would say that the hate against registered citizens is justified. We're convicted of a sex-related crime. You know, the range is huge, as we just discussed. It could be something, you know, peeing in a park versus child abuse, or even worse than that, rape or whatever it may be. Is that hate? A lot of people would say it's justified. What would you say to that? I mean, basically, these people need to be punished.
First, I would just come back to the enormous scale of the people who are caught up in the sex offender regime. I call it the sex offender regime is a set of institutions and practices and laws that were kind of cobbled together over the last few decades and are now kind of gelled into hard form, and they reproduce the concept. There are currently 850,000 registered sex offenders in the U.S. at last count. That's a huge population. And if you think about the degree of animus and discrimination and exclusion and so on, being directed against minor offenders, it would seem unwise to orchestrate that degree of hatred based on that. My second point would be that I think I would make a civil libertarian case for the worst offenders. I mean, obviously there are repeat rapists. Obviously there are people who did horrible things to children. Obviously there are people who have committed grave crimes against other human beings. You know, those would be my two levels of response, and one has to do with scale and disproportionality, and the other one has to do with what kind of normal laws do we want? What do we want to normalize in the apparatus of law? Because if you start hyper-punishing sex offenders, you'll probably also start to hyper-punish other kinds of offenders as well.
Do you think the media is adding to the fear and creating hate against registered citizens and their families? I do want to point that out. That's a very important area there, is their families as well, because they are affected. Do you think the media is to blame for most of this hate and fear?
When you had the expansion of vehicles like CNN and Fox and so on, they've got basically 24 hours to fill. So they go. The strong tendency is for the media to start bottom feeding on very sensational stories that create a lot of emotion and angst and panic in the general public. The news increasingly was unable to resist stories that shock, horrify, scandalize, and so on. And then we move on to the next outrage. So you get a news cycle that starts to increasingly look like the worst tabloid products. And I think that plays a very big role in sustaining the kind of emotional response that the public often has.
Statistics show that the registry, as Ed, you mentioned, really doesn't make our community safer, but people are still hanging on to the thought that the registries do, that they do help.
There were only a handful of states that had sex offender registries. Then Megan's Law was passed 2 years later in 1996, and it augmented the Wetterling Act. It required local police to notify communities of sex offenders living in their presence. So what you get, I don't believe the actual law required web notification, but the way it was implemented everywhere was that it became the assumption that that local authorities would notify communities by using public online registries, because the web was growing up at the same time these laws were spreading. So you had a perfect storm for new, absolutely new kinds of, I call it scarlet letters, right? I mean, it's a flashback to Puritanism in some way, but it's on this digital platform.
For some reason, society enjoys, I don't know if they enjoy it, but it's part of human nature, I guess, is segregating into groups. So the others that are not on the list feel like they're not a part of that group. They're safe. They're not part of the sex offender registry. They're not part of a hate crime registry, which was proposed as well. Is that part of like the social exclusion?
There's an argument that punishment in America has a very democratic element. Like Americans like this will come off too strong, but let's say it and then we can pull it back some. Americans like to see other people punished, and they like to participate in the punishment of other people. I mean, there's an argument that this is a very deep strand of punishment in America going back to the Puritan era, right? I mean, what happens after the 1970s is that the democratization of criminal justice tends increasingly towards expressive punishments. These are not rehabilitative punishments. These are not punishments where the miscreant does his time, rehabilitates himself, makes himself a better man, and moves on, right? These are punishments that are designed to publicly express social condemnation, and they're potentially unlimited, right? The timeline on that goes on and expands and expands. And what it sets up is literally a regime that ends up in a condition of permanent social exclusion. The people who are subject to these punishments experience what Orlando Patterson calls social death. And it also tends to become a condition under which you have fewer and fewer human rights.
I mean, I understand. Look, I understand, and I think you understand, that there are people that need to be watched that have done horrific things. But for the majority of the people in the registry, when they hear the safety zone, it makes them feel they're dangerous, and they can, you know, snatch a child at any moment.
This doesn't ever allow the restoration of the person to his family and community. It's designed to isolate and segregate and marginalize the person forever.
Well, that's like Miami-Dade County. They're seeing a crisis now where people are living again in an encampment.
A lot of places ended up housing sex offender registrants in remote Motel 6s or some low-cost motel like that, if it were located far enough away from the safety
zones. And the families, I'm sorry to interrupt, the families go through these, you know, they feel segregated as well, and they go through the trauma of dealing with that.
If you're a registrant who's lucky enough to have a family, I mean, often this, as you might well imagine, this process is very hard on families, and it tends to break families up. I can't cite a study. I do know cases because of my own research, but this tends to bust up families pretty quickly because most people can't go through it. So that would be the second pillar of the regime. We've talked a lot about the registries. The zones of banishment are really a truly atavistic addition. Sometimes people say to me, yeah, I get what you're saying, but I'm worried about my children, and I'm worried about what they might encounter in the streets. And I'm genuinely, and these people are genuinely concerned about public safety. What I often say in response, though, is to say something like, well, look, I mean, think about how burgeoning these laws are. Think about how widely they apply. Think about how many people are being caught up in it. And you might actually worry that your child would be one of the people who gets caught up in it, because these systems have expanded very rapidly, and they've gone so far as to take in teenagers who are really basically doing things that are just part of ordinary adolescent sexual experimentation.
Thank you, Dr. Roger Lancaster, for spending time with me today and providing us some great information for the Gonzaga University Institute of Hate Studies Conference.
Thank you. It was a pleasure being here.
For more information on Women Against Registry, you can check out their website on the screen. There's also some other links for more resources. And of course, solitarynationpodcast.com for more episodes like the one we just finished with Dr. Roger Lancaster. Thanks again. My name is Matt Duhamel. Join me next time.